وإني أسألك سؤال خاضع متذلل خاشع، أن تسامحني وترحمني وتجعلني بقسمك راضيا قانعا، وفي جميع الأحوال متواضعا. اللهم وأسألك سؤال من اشتدت فاقته وأنزل بك عند الشدائد حاجته وعظم فيما عندك رغبته. اللهم عظم سلطانك وعلى مكانك وخفي مكرك وظهر أمرك وغلب قهرك وجرت قدرتك ولا يمكن الفرار من حكومتك. اللهم لا أجد لذنوبي غافرا ولا لقبائحي ساترا ولا لشيء من عملي القبيح بالحسن مبدلا غيرك، لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك وبحمدك. ظلمت نفسي وتجرأت بجهلي وسكنت إلى قديم ذكرك لي ومنك علي. اللهم مولاي، كم من قبيح سترته وكم من فادح من البلاء أقلته وكم من عثار وقيته وكم من مكروه دفعته وكم من ثناء جميل لست أهلا له نشرته. اللهم عظم بلائي وأفرط بي سوء حالي وقصرت بي أعمالي وقعدت بي أغلالي وحبسني عن نفعي بعد أملي وخدعتني الدنيا بغرورها ونفسي بجنايتها ومطالي. يا سيدي، فأسألك بعزتك أن لا يحجب عنك دعائي سوء عملي وفعالي ولا تفضحني بخفي ما اطلعت عليه من سري ولا تعاجلني بالعقوبة على ما عملته في خلواتي من سوء فعلي وإساءتي ودوام تفريطي وجهالتي وكثرة شهواتي وغفلتي. وكن اللهم بعزتك لي في كل الأحوال رؤوفا وعلي في جميع الأمور عطوفا. إلهي وربي من لي غيرك أسأله كشف ضري والنظر في أمري. إلهي ومولاي، أجريت علي حكما اتبعت فيه هوى نفسي ولم أحترس فيه من تزيين عدوي، فغرني بما أهوى وأسعده على ذلك القضاء، فتجاوزت بما جرى علي من ذلك بعض حدودك وخالفت بعض أوامرك، فلك الحجة علي في جميع ذلك ولا حجة لي فيما جرى علي فيه قضاؤك، وألزمني حكمك وبلاؤك. وقد أتيتك يا إلهي بعد تقصيري وإسرافي على نفسي، معتذرا نادما منكسرا مستقيلا مستغفرا منيبا مقرا مذعنا معترفا. لا أجد مفرا مما كان مني ولا مفزعا أتوجه إليه في أمري غير قبولك عذري وإدخالك إياي في سعتي رحمتك. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد.
صلي على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم فاقبل عذري وارحم شدة ضري وفكني من شدي وثاقي. يا رب ارحم ضعف بدني، يا رب ارحم ضعف بدني، يا رب ارحم ضعف بدني ورقة جلدي ودقة عظمي. يا من بدأ خلقي وذكري وتربيتي وبري وتغذيتي، هبني لابتداء كرمك وسالفي برك بي. يا إلهي وسيدي وربي، أتراك معذبي بنارك بعد توحيدك وبعد من طوى عليه قلبي من معرفتك ولهج به لساني من ذكرك واعتقده ضميري من حبك وبعد صدق اعترافي ودعائي خاضعا لربوبيتك؟ هيهات، أنت أكرم من أن تضيع من ربيته أو تبعد من أدنيته أو تشرد من آويته أو تسلم إلى البلاء من كفيته ورحمته. وليت شعري يا سيدي وإلهي ومولاي أتسلط النار على وجوه خرت لعظمتك ساجدا وعلى ألسن نطقت بتوحيدك صادقة وبشكرك مادحة وعلى قلوب اعترفت بإلهيتك محققة وعلى ضمائر حوت من العلم بك حتى صارت خاشعة وعلى جوارح سعت إلى أوطان تعبدك طائعة وأشارت باستغفارك مذعنا. ما هكذا الظن بك ولا أخبرنا بفضلك عنك يا كريم. يا ربي وأنت تعلم ضعفي عن قليل من بلاء الدنيا وعقوباتها وما يجري فيها من المكاره على أهلها، على أن ذلك بلاء ومكروه، قليل مكثوه، يسير بقاؤه، قصير مدته، فكيف احتمالي لبلاء الآخرة وجليل وقوع المكاره فيها وهو بلاء تطول مدته ويدوم مقامه ولا يخفف عن أهله؟ لأنه لا يكون إلا عن غضبك وانتقامك وسخطك، وهذا ما لا تقوم له السماوات والأرض. يا سيدي فكيف بي وأنا عبدك الضعيف الذليل الحقير المسكين المستكين؟ يا إلهي وربي وسيدي ومولاي، لأي الأمور إليك أشكو ولما منها أضج وأبكي؟ لأليم العذاب وشدته أم لطول البلاء ومدته؟ فلئن صيرت وجمعتني للعقوبات مع أعدائك، وجمعت بيني وبين أهلي بلائك، وفرقت بيني وبين أحبائك وأوليائك. فهبني يا إلهي وسيدي ومولاي وربي، صبرت على عذابك فكيف أصبر على فراقك؟ وهبني صبرت على حر نارك فكيف أصبر عن النظر إلى كرامتك؟ أم كيف أسكن في النار ورجائي عفوك؟ فبعزتك يا سيدي ومولاي أقسم صادقا، لأن تركتني ناطقا لأضجن إليك بين أهلها ضجيج الآملين، ولأصرخن إليك صراخ المستصرخين، ولأبكين عليك بكاء الفاقدين، ولأنادينك أين كنت يا ولي المؤمنين؟ يا غاية آمال العارفين، يا غياث المستغيثين، يا غياث المستغيثين، يا حبيب قلوب الصادقين، ويا إله العالمين. أفتراك سبحانك يا إلهي وبحمدك تسمع فيها صوت عبد مسلم سجن فيها بمخالفته، وذاق طعم عذابها بمعصيته، وحبس بين أطباقها بجرمه وجريرته، وهو يضج إليك ضجيج مؤمل لرحمتك، ويناديك بلسان أهل توحيدك، ويتوسل إليك بربوبيتك. يا مولاي، فكيف يبقى في العذاب وهو يرجو ما سلف من حلمك؟ أم كيف تؤلمه النار وهو يأمل فضلك ورحمتك؟ أم كيف يحرقه لهيبها وأنت تسمع صوته وترى مكانه؟ أم كيف يشتمل عليه زفيرها وأنت تعلم ضعفه؟ أم كيف يتقلقل بين أطباقها وأنت تعلم صدقه؟ أم كيف تزجره زبانيتها وهو يناديك يا رباه؟ أم كيف يرجو فضلك في عتقه منها فتتركه فيها؟ هيهات، ما ذلك الظن بك؟ ولا المعروف من فضلك، ولا مشبه لما عاملت به الموحدين من برك وإحسانك. فباليقين أقطع، لولا ما حكمت به من تعذيب جاحديك وقضيت به من إخلاد معانديك، لجعلت النار كلها بردا وسلاما، وما كان لأحد فيها مقرا ولا مقاما. لكنك تقدست أسماؤك، أقسمت أن تملأها من الكافرين، من الجنة والناس أجمعين، وأن تخلد فيها المعاندين، وأن تجلى ثناؤك. قلت مبتدئا وتطولت بالإنعام متكرما، أفمن كان مؤمنا كمن كان فاسقا لا يستوون؟ إلهي وسيدي، فأسألك بالقدرة التي قدرتها، وبالقضية التي حتمتها وحكمتها، وغلبت من عليه أجريتها، أن تهب لي في هذه الليلة وفي هذه الساعة كل جرم أجرمته، وكل ذنب أذنبته، وكل قبيح أسررته، وكل جهل عملته، كتمته أو أعلنته، أخفيته أو أظهرته، وكل سيئة أمرت بإثباتها الكرام الكاتبين الذين وكلتهم بحفظ ما يكون مني، وجعلتهم شهودا علي مع جوارحي، وكنت أنت الرقيب علي من ورائهم والشاهد لما خفي عنهم، وبرحمتك أخفيته وبفضلك سترته، وأن توفر حظي من كل خير تنزله، أو إحسان تفضله، أو بر تنشره، أو رزق تبسطه، أو ذنب تغفره، أو خطأ تستره. يا ربي يا ربي يا رب، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب،
يا ربي يا ربي يا رب. يا إلهي وسيدي ومولاي ومالك رقي، يا من بيده ناصيتي، يا عليما بضري ومسكنتي، يا خبيرا بفقري وفاقتي، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب. أسألك بحقك وقدسك وأعظم صفاتك وأسمائك أن تجعل أوقاتي من الليل والنهار بذكرك معمورة، وبخدمتك موصولة، وأعمالي عندك مقبولة، حتى تكون أعمالي وأورادي كلها وردا واحدا، وحالي في خدمتك سرمدا. يا سيدي يا من عليه معولي، يا من إليه شكوت أحوالي، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب. قوي على خدمتك جوارحي، واشدد على العزيمة جوانحي، وهب لي الجد في خشيتك، والدوام في الاتصال بخدمتك، حتى أسرح إليك في ميادين السابقين، وأسرع إليك في البارزين، وأشتاق إلى قربك في المشتاقين، وأدنو منك دنو المخلصين، وأخافك مخافة الموقنين، وأجتمع في جوارك مع المؤمنين. اللهم ومن أرادنا بسوء فارد، ومن كادنا فكد. اللهم ومن أراد المسلمين بسوء فارد، ومن كادهم فكد. واجعلني من أحسن عبيدك نصيبا عندك، وأقربهم منزلة منك، وأخصهم زلفة لديك، فإنه لا ينال ذلك إلا بفضلك. وجد لي بجودك، واعطف علي بمجدك، واحفظني برحمتك، واجعل لساني بذكرك لهجا، وقلبي بحبك متيما، ومن علي بحسن إجابتك، وأقلني عثرتي، واغفر زلتي، فإنك قضيت على عبادك بعبادتك، وأمرتهم بدعائك، وضمنت لهم الإجابة، فإليك يا ربي نصبت وجهي، وإليك يا ربي مددت يدي، فبعزتك استجب لي دعائي، وبلغني مناي، ولا تقطع من فضلك رجائي، واكفني شر الجن والإنس من أعدائي. يا سريع الرضا، يا سريع الرضا، اغفر لمن لا يملك إلا الدعاء، فإنك فعال لما تشاء. يا من اسمه دواء وذكره شفاء وطاعته غنى، ارحم من رأسماله الرجاء وسلاحه البكاء. يا سابغ النعم، يا دافق، يا دافع النقام، يا نور المستوحشين في الظلام، يا عالما لا يعلم، صل على محمد وآل محمد، وافعل بنا ما أنت أهله. وصلى الله على رسوله والأئمة الميامين من آله وسلم تسليما كثيرا.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم، اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم، اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم. وزور سيدي ومولاي أبا عبد الله الحسين أصالة عن نفسي ونيابة عن والدي ووالد والدي ومن قلدني الدعاء والزيارة بندبها قربة إلى الله تعالى. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليك يا وارث آدم صفوة الله، السلام عليك يا وارث نوح النبي الله، السلام عليك يا وارث إبراهيم خليل الله، السلام عليك يا وارث موسى كليم الله، السلام عليك يا وارث عيسى روح الله، السلام عليك يا وارث محمد حبيب الله، السلام عليك يا وارث أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام، السلام عليك يا ابن محمد المصطفى، السلام عليك يا ابن علي المرتضى، السلام عليك يا ابن فاطمة الزهراء، السلام عليك يا ابن خديجة الكبرى، السلام عليك يا ثار الله وابن ثاره والوتر الموتور. أشهد أنك قد أقمت الصلاة وآتيت الزكاة وأمرت بالمعروف ونهيت عن المنكر وأطعت الله ورسوله حتى أتاك اليقين، فلعن الله أمة قتلتك، ولعن الله أمة ظلمتك، ولعن الله أمة سمعت بذلك فرضيت به. يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله، أشهد أنك كنت نورا في الأصلاب الشامخة والأرحام المطهرة، لم تنجسك الجاهلية بأنجاسها، ولم تلبسك من مدلهمات ثيابها، وأشهد أنك من دعائم الدين وأركان المؤمنين، وأشهد أنك الإمام البر التقي الرضي الزكي الهادي المهدي، وأشهد أن الأئمة من ولدك كلمة التقوى وأعلام الهدى والعروة الوثقى والحجة على أهل الدنيا. وأشهد الله وملائكته وأنبياءه ورسله أني بكم مؤمن وبإيابكم موقن، بشرائع ديني وخواتيم عملي، وقلبي لقلبكم سلم، وأمري لأمركم متبع، صلوات الله عليكم وعلى أرواحكم وعلى أجسادكم وعلى أجسامكم وعلى شاهدكم وعلى غائبكم وعلى ظاهركم وعلى باطنكم. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. السلام عليك يا رسول الله، السلام عليك يا أمير المؤمنين، السلام عليك سيدتي مولاتي فاطمة سيدتي نساء العالمين، السلام على الحسن بن علي، السلام على الحسين بن علي، السلام على سيدي مولاي علي بن الحسين زين العابدين، السلام على سيدي مولاي محمد بن علي الباقر، السلام على سيدي مولاي جعفر بن محمد الصادق، السلام على سيدي مولاي باب الحوائج موسى بن جعفر الكاظم، السلام على باب المراد، السلام على سيدي مولاي علي بن موسى الرضا، السلام على باب المراد سيدي مولاي محمد بن علي الجواد، السلام على سيدي مولاي علي بن محمد الهادي، السلام على سيدي مولاي الحسن بن علي العسكري، السلام عليك يا سيدي يا مولاي يا صاحب الزمان، الأمان الأمان الأمان، الغوث الغوث الغوث، صلوات الله عليكم جميعا. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائي في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة، وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا، حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا، برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. وإلى من مات على ولاية أمير المؤمنين نهدي الجميع مباركة الفاتحة مع الصلوات.
تقبل الله كنت سيو سلام الله تقبل الله السلام عليكم how are you تقبل الله السلام عليكم how are you حاج how are you السلام عليكم how are you حاج كنت سيو هي راح نسوي لك مجال تقبل الله no no I don't think إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
إن شاء الله لنصرة الإسلام والمسلمين ولخذل الكفار والمنافقين والمشركين والظلمة ولقضاء الحوائج ولشفاء المرضى نقرأ الآية المباركة بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء 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 أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه. يا الله يا الله يا الله، اللهم اكشف ما بنا من سوء، اللهم اقضي حوائج المحتاجين، اشف مرضانا ومرضى المؤمنين والمؤمنات، انصر الإسلام والمسلمين، واخذل الكفر والمنافقين، وسدد علماءنا العاملين وإخواننا المجاهدين، واهدي شبابنا لما فيه الصلاح والإصلاح، وإلى أرواح أمواتكم وأمواتنا وأموات المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات، لا سيما العلماء والشهداء، رحم الله من يقرأ الفاتحة مع الصلوات.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
أنتم محسنين. No, I'm not. Thank you. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على أشرف الخلق والأنبياء والمرسلين، سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا وقاد مسيرتنا محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه المنتجبين وعلى جميع أنبياء الله المرسلين. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Dear brothers and sisters, inshallah nubarak lakum the anniversary of al-mab'ath al-nabawi and al-isra wal-mi'raj. Inshallah Eid mubarak for all of you for the occasion of the prophet's prophetic mission and the event of isra and mi'raj. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes. So always, some people think they are the same. It is different. Mab'ath is the day that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got Allah's command to preach or to deliver the message of Allah subhanahu wa taala. Isra wal Mi'raj, it is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took his prophet in a journey to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in Jerusalem and then to the heaven. So these are different occasions, not at the same time. And the second one, Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, it was in the it was on the seventh year or it was in Mecca after the Ba'tha, after the, like, you know, the prophet's mission. So talking about this great occasion of Al-Ba'tha al-Nabawiyya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran in Surah Al-Jumu'ah, verse number 2, هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين. He it is who raised among the inhabitants of Mecca a messenger from among themselves who recites to them his communications and purifies them and teaches them the book and the wisdom. Although they were before certainly in a clear error. So the Prophet ﷺ was sent to Quraysh. And that was just the beginning, of course. He was sent to the whole world, but he's supposed to start from certain city, point, people, and then it is going to spread out. So Imam Ali alayhi salam was telling us about what the Prophet did. In Nahjul Balagha, it is Sermon 95, he says, بَعَثَهُ وَالنَّاسُ ضُلَّالٌ فِي حَيْرَةٍ واستزلتهم الكبرياء وحاطبون في فتنة قد استهوتهم الأهواء. The Prophet was sent by Allah during a time when people were lost and causing trouble. They were led astray by their desires and arrogance. So this is just to tell us about him and to give you another like idea about even the goal of an average person in Arabia, like, is not more than, like when they ask one of them, what is your big goal in this life? He said, fill up my stomach, like eat until I will be can't eat more, and then drink whatever he drinks, even alcohol, and sleep under the sun, or under the shadow of Kaaba. That's it, done. Like he thinks about himself only. This same person was changed after Islam, that he has a message. He has a big goal in his life to carry the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to carry Islam to the last point on this world. And that's what happened when you see their sacrifice, their commitment, and how much they devoted for the sake of Islam, and how much they sacrificed for the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then, dear brothers and sisters, I think especially that we need to reread, and especially for the youth, to read about how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so successful to deliver the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to read about it. He spent 13 years in Mecca. So it is started on the 27th of Rajab that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded his prophet to start the mission. But no, it was before that. So he started before that, of course. The Prophet must be prepared for that mission. So as some of the, like, you know, historians said, that he was prepared 4 years before that mission. When he started to go to that cave of Hira and to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or meditate and for 4 years. And one of the scholars, he said something very nice. He said, as if he had Islam in his mind, in his soul, in every cell in his body, before it was revealed to him. And the spirituality of believing one God and guided by the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like, you know, overflowed his mind and heart and even his morals. So that's why he was called, even before he got the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, As-Sadiq al-Amin. Okay? The honest, the trustworthy. And they didn't even find one lie in his whole life before he got the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or to deliver the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And even in other narrations that he knew that he is going to get, like, you know, something from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in some narrations that they said even some of the rocks will say, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulallah. It is unlike the other narrations saying that when he got the revelation, when Jibreel came to him and he squeezed him or hugged him and squeezed him, and he said, read. He said, what should I read? And then he was so confused, he was so scared, he went back to his wife. He said he wasn't, like, you know, certain about what happened to him, and then he needed a help from her cousin to tell him that you are the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not acceptable, of course, at all, you know. So he was prepared for 4 years until he got that day when Jibreel alayhi salam came to him and he said, Iqra. He asked him, what should I read? He said, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. The 5 ayahs in Surah Al-Alaq, okay, which is a great, and that was the beginning that you need to start delivering the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the first 2 to 3 years, it was a secret call. So he communicated with his close friends, people that he knows they might accept the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And some of them accepted it, some of them maybe not, but some few of them, they converted to Islam. Regardless of this kind of security procedures that should be secretly, the news leaked and Quraysh started to hear about, you know, a new call. Someone is calling for one God and to abandon all the, you know, idols that we have. But they thought it is like other cults, like Qas ibn Sa'idah and others. They didn't like the tradition and the faith of their people, pre-Islam era, the Jahiliyyah, worshipping the idols and doing bad stuff. So they were searching for, like, another religion, all right, that they can accept it. So they thought this is going to be the same. And of course they went out of Mecca and no one is remembering them. But that was different. That message, that call was totally different. So what happened after these two to three years? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him, now it is time to do what? وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ. You need to warn your close relatives. So what he did, he asked Imam Ali alayhi salam, when he was in the first year of his, like, being a youth, and he asked him to prepare a lunch for, of course, his uncles, the leaders of Banu Hashim. And he did. And when they came in, it was little food, and even one of them, can eat the whole food. But each one of them ate from it, and they were full. So before the Prophet started to talk, Abu Lahab, his uncle, said, لَقَدْ سَحَرَكُمُ الرَّجُلُ. Like Muhammad, he like had a magic on you. How come that we are full with eating only few bites? And then the Prophet told Imam Ali alayhi salam, you know, this man, he interrupted me, so I couldn't say anything. After 2 or 3 days, he invited them again, and he started to tell them about that he is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He got, you know, to preach and to deliver the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he asked them, May you aziruni ala hadha al-amr. Who is going to support me with this matter? Yakun akhi wa wasiyyi wa khalifati fikum. And he is going to be my brother, my guardian, and my successor among you. Everyone hesitated, they were silent. But Imam Ali alayhi salam, Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, he said, أنا أؤازرك يا رسول الله. I'm the one who's going to support you and be with you. So the Prophet repeated his statement. No one responded to him but Ali alayhi salam. So he repeated his statement for 3 times, and no one accepted that but Imam Ali alayhi salam. And he repeated that 3 times. Now everyone heard about it. What was the reaction of Quraysh? At the beginning, they didn't think that it is going to affect every house in Mecca, and not just in Mecca, even if it is out of Mecca. And the Prophet ﷺ started to communicate with people who are coming for the season of Hajj, okay, when they came as pilgrims. And he used to go and meet with the leaders of the clans or, you know, tribes. Talk to them individually. And talk to them. And he convinced many of them. And maybe, you know, it was the best way to make this kind of propaganda about Islam. Telling others, even though they will not accept it, but they will go and tell others about it. So the news spread out. You cannot stop it. So Quraysh at the beginning, they thought, this is number one, it is going to be ended soon, but it didn't. Number two, they couldn't really weigh the value or the seriousness of this new message. And they thought it is not very dangerous, but then they found out it was out of control. Now, what should they do? Imagine those people who used to, like, be the leaders of Quraysh and practice injustice, practice all the deviation by worshipping the idols. There were 360 idols inside Kaaba and on the Kaaba, and, you know, they were doing all the bad stuff. They have deviated the tradition of Hajj, which is, it is the Abrahamic Hajj, and so on and so forth. And they found out that this new call, this new message, is really threatening their positions. What should they do? Of course, they held many meetings. How can we control this message? How can we end it? So, as these days, brothers and sisters, when we see true Islam practiced, they will try to stop it from spreading or to be effective. And the first thing is, what should they call it? This is what we call the war of media, or it is about, you know, what kind of propaganda or how we can encounter what is going on. So, number one, spread out the word about Muhammad. That's what they decided, that he was a magician. He was a liar. He was a poet. Even his uncle, Abu Lahab, used to walk behind him Whenever the Prophet is going to talk to people, so he will do what? Tell people, this is my nephew and he's a liar. Don't listen to him. To this point, even his wife, like, you know, Abu Lahab's wife, all right, she was inciting the slaves to hurt the Prophet and to, like, always, like, whenever he goes back home or gets out, they will put a lot of stuff in front of his door so he cannot walk easily and so on and so forth. But all of that didn't work. People started to believe him. With any message, with any new call, even when someone is telling you, okay, if you want to buy this product, for example, some of them they will believe in that, some of them they will not, some of them will be neutral. But in this case in Mecca, some of them they believed in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some of them they were against it, and especially those were the Quraysh leaders. And of course, still the majority they didn't believe. But in every house, after 7, 8, 10 years, in every house, there is one person, either a male or a female, converted to Islam or about to convert to Islam. Imagine. So they were in a big trouble. Then, what should we do? They said, okay, let's, you know, there is a guy called An-Nadhr, and he traveled to, like, Persia, and he learned about the stories of, you know, their kings. And they said, okay, Muhammad is telling stories. Let this person also sit next to him and affect what Muhammad is doing. But of course, when people are listening to the Quran and the nice words uttered by the Prophet, they will not be convinced with the other person. He said, okay, Muhammad is telling you this, I'm going to tell you even some other stories. And no one is going to believe that person. So, why? Because it is Allah's words and it comes from the heart. And they can recognize that this person, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was telling the truth. That he's not a liar, he's not a magician, and he's not a poet. So what is he? He is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So number one, they tried to stop him with all these ways, they failed. Let's go to the next step. Like these days, I don't know if you have heard about some of the messages, we'll get to some of the countries that they supported the Palestinians. We are going to give you this amount of money, we are going to do this to you, just to stop supporting people in Palestine. This kind of bargaining, this mentality started from even that time or even before. They started to bargain with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We are going to make you our king. But stop preaching. He said no. We are going to give you money to be the richest person in Mecca. He said no. They said okay. We are going to worship your Lord, your God, 1 year, and you worship our God the other year. He said, no. You see, all these bargaining failed. So what should they do? Again, they started the propaganda about the Prophet. He is a liar, he is this and that, as we just mentioned. These days, what do they call the Muslims? Terrorists. Okay? Whatever you say, it is anti-Semitic, whatever you want to do, oh, you are this or that, something similar. No difference. What else? They started to hurt Muslims, the new converts, and to torture them. Of course, they cannot touch the free men. They cannot touch, like, for example, Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, Ali ibn Abi Talib. Okay? They cannot touch them. But of course, they will come to the weak ones, to the slaves, and they will torture them. And they tortured them to the extent that they killed Sumayya, Ammar's mother, and she became the first martyr in Islam. And then they killed Ammar's father. He also became the martyr, Yasir. So both of them, they were killed. But what about the Muslims? When they saw this kind of reaction, torturing, hurting, they were labeled with all these, like, you know, labels, terrorists or whatever. Did they stop? No, they didn't. And let me tell you about three stories of about the three converts or three Sahaba who converted to Islam. Number one is Abu Dharr al-Ghifari. When he came to Mecca and he heard the Prophet, what he said, and there is a very nice story that he asked Imam Ali alayhi salam, how can I meet with Muhammad? He said, okay, you can follow me at night secretly. And then he met with the Prophet and he was convinced totally, 100%. And the Prophet told him, okay, you need to go back home and tell your tribe about this religion and work secretly. He said, no. I want to declare Islam in front of all people of Quraysh. And he went to the Masjid al-Haram and he started to say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. So what happened? People of Mecca started to beat him up until they are about to kill him. Then Al-Abbas ibn Abd al-Muttalib took him out of their hands. And he repeated that the second day. He wasn't afraid. He challenged the whole people about his faith. This is one example. And the Prophet told us about him that he is saying the truth until he dies. One of the strong people in faith was Abu Dharr al-Ghifari rahmatullahi alayh. The other person, he was Mus'ab ibn Umayr, this a true companion. Some people will think, oh, only Muslims, they were poor, that beginning, who accepted Islam, they were the poorest ones, the weak ones, the slaves. No, Mus'ab ibn Umayr was born and raised in a rich family. He was a kind of a spoiled kid. Even in some narrations saying that when he walks in the alley, like for example, when he just passed, you can smell the perfume that he had. His clothes, the richest clothes. This person accepted Islam. And the Prophet washed him in the Shi'ab Abi Talib when they were for like 2 to 3 years under sanction, with no food, with no nothing, that he was starving and half naked. And then the Prophet, he just stood up and said, oh my God, I remember him when he was walking the streets of Mecca with his fancy clothes, expensive clothes. He was so rich, so spoiled, so like, he got everything. But look what faith is going to do to those people. This is the second example. That's why, dear brothers and sisters, I am asking you to read how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were so successful about preaching and convincing people to be Muslims. The third example, dear brothers and sisters, he is Suhaib al-Rumi. So he was originally from Rome, and he is a Roman person. And he came, of course, as like, you know, slave. Then he abolished himself by paying out to his master his prize. And he started to work with, like, you know, trading, and he became a very rich person. When he decided to migrate to Medina, the Meccan people told him,
You should leave everything here. You cannot take anything from your property. Your money, whatever you can take. You came as a poor person, you should leave as a poor person. He said, it's okay with me. For the sake of Islam, I will do this. It's not a big problem for me. So, this is another lesson, dear brothers and sisters, about how much Islam can change people and make them so resilient. And when we read about the sanction about Muslims, it was really a big test for them. When they couldn't, associate with others, they cannot marry from other tribes, nor other tribes can marry women from them, and at the same time they cannot buy any food. And Quraysh, as we see the sanctions, these days, when these countries will post sanctions on other countries and prevent them from buying maybe food or some certain medications and so on and so forth, something exactly happened to Muslims at that time. They couldn't even buy food. And Quraysh was buying all the food, like the wheat and, barley and other like dates or whatever, to prevent the Prophet and his tribe from buying it and eating it. So how they survived? Only with some people who secretly at night will bring the load of one camel, like on a camel. When they reach their area, they will unleash the camel and hit him to go and get the food to the Prophet and his people. That's it. They ate herbs, grass, and even the leaves of the trees to survive. But they didn't lose their faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Quraysh, when they imposed this kind of sanction on the Prophet, they said, the result of this sanction is either one of two. Either he is going to die, we are going to kill him, or he is going to surrender. None of these options, or what they wished happened. Then some honest leaders of Quraysh gathered, and especially those who have a relationship, like their moms from Bani Hashim, they started this movement to stop the sanction. And then in two narrations, they decided, let's see that agreement. It was on a piece of skin, and it was eaten by the insect, except the name of Allah. But the other story, which is more reliable, that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told his uncle Abu Talib that Allah, my Lord, told me that skin, which they have the agreement and the names of those people who signed it, all of it was eaten by the insect except the name of Allah. He said, your God told you that? He said, yes. And he went to Quraysh and he told them, that's what my cousin told me. If it is true, you need to stop the sanction. If it is not, I'm going to deliver Muhammad to you. They said, we accepted. And they signed an agreement on it. You see, he was smart. He is not going to get there, consent only verbally. It is written too. And then when they found out what he said, what he was saying, is it true? They were shocked, especially Abu Sufyan and Abu Jahl and others. So after that, dear brothers and sisters, the hurting Muslims and torturing the weak ones continued. Also, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraged some of the Muslims to migrate to Habasha, It is not true, as it is narrated, that, oh, just to get rid of torture. No. The majority of those who migrated to Habasha, they were free men. They weren't slaves. This is number one. Number two, they didn't come back until the seventh year after Hijrah, after migration, when the Prophet ﷺ conquered Khaybar. And when he saw Ja'far ibn Abi Talib came back, he was so pleased. He said, I don't know which I'm pleased more with, conquering Khaybar or returning of Ja'far. So they got the news that Muslims, they migrated to Medina and they were very successful and so on and so forth. Yet, why they migrated? To open new horizons for the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as if the Prophet is telling them, regardless of your torture and hurting Muslims, we are convincing even other people overseas about Islam. We are not going to stop. So dear brothers and sisters, what do we get? Number one, strong belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِن تَنصُرُوا اللَّهَ يَنصُرْكُمْ وَيُثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَكُمْ. This equation, till today, we can see it by our eyes. We can see how come 313 Muslims confronted 1,000 of the mushrikeen and they got the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Till today, we can see this equation will apply to those sincere people who are fighting injustice. Regardless of all the media, what they are saying, regardless of all the, evil plans or negotiations, they will prevail. Why? Trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah is going to be with you. Number two, have patience. Constant patience. Be committed to your cause, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Muslims did. They didn't give up until they got the victory. And number three, dear brothers and sisters, always try to find new ways to improve yourselves, to open new horizons for your message. And don't say, okay, people are not listening, or we are afraid of this and that. This is not what the first Muslims did. The first Muslims, they always trusted in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, did what they're supposed to do, and they got the help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is what we need when we remember this great event of Al-Bi'tha al-Nabawiyya al-Sharifa, the prophetic mission of the Prophet. We need to read the history to apply it to our daily life. We need to be born with this event and to remember the heroic stance of Muslims and apply it to our life. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.